we're going to reconvene the meeting, so I'd like to ask everybody to please either take a seat, or if you're going to continue talking, that's fine, but you need to go outside the commission chambers, please.
It is on. It's just loud.
Thanks, everybody. We're going to restart the meeting, so please take a seat if you're staying for the next agenda item. And if you are not staying for the next agenda item, that is okay. And but please go ahead and exit the commission chamber so we can move on to the next item.
In the kitchen.
Question, Dr. Green. Do we need to vote on these?
You're going to have to gavel them again, Chairman. You're going to have to gavel them.
We need everybody to please be quiet. And if you're not staying for the next agenda item, please go ahead and exit the commission chambers at this time. We need to start the meeting again. Thank you.
Do we need to vote on the budget amendment specifically for the Oak Hill funding?
Your motion is a vote on all three.
Okay.
Okay.
Could we just clarify from the commissioners who made the motion and seconded it that the motion includes utilization of the Oak Hill funding for part of the year one funding?
Yes.
Great. All right. That'll be reflected in the minutes. All right. Thanks, everybody. All right. The next item on our agenda is the Justice Resource Center. And Mandy Stone will introduce this item for us. Thank you.
Chairman and Commissioners, I feel like this is a natural transition from the presentation that we just had. Again, this is a commissioner-driven initiative where commissioners began asking court officials and experts in behavioral health fields, what are we doing right, and where are their gaps, and where are their opportunities to bring additional best practices? As a result of that, staff again had the honor to try to organize the work, and in doing so brought together an oversight of our judicial leadership who would, if this is approved, manage this project moving forward. And I think that's a really important point. I'd like to remind of some of the folks you already mentioned, but our Chief District Court Judge Calvin Hill is here and a part of this, and will be part of the oversight. We also had all of Judge Hill's bench. All of the district court judges had been briefed on the model and had the opportunity for input. Our senior resident Superior Court Judge, Alan Thornburg, who called me as well as Todd Williams to say he totally supports moving forward and looks forward to the role he can play. Our clerk of court, the Honorable Steve Cogburn, is here, who plays an integral role in anything that works in the court system. Our district attorney, Todd Williams, who you heard from earlier. Public defender, Leanne Melton. Our sheriff, Van Duncan, who, as you know, has oversight of the detention facility and related programs. Probation and parole, Laurie Anderson. And pretrial with Kim Mortez. I would also tell you that two key staff in moving forward are Rachel Nygaard, who will provide planner evaluation support, and Dr. Lee Creighton, who will provide the dashboards and the accounting and reporting out of the project if you approve it tonight. Next, if you can bring up the PowerPoint. I could not in any way articulate better than the individuals you've just heard from, nor from the parents you heard from earlier who lost a child to an opiate overdose, that there are opportunities to serve some segments of our criminal justice system in a more effective and more cost-efficient manner. In our jail last year, more than 7,500 people moved through those. Of that number, 70% were low-level, nonviolent offenses. That gives us an opportunity, as District Attorney Williams said, to look at a different approach to serving those populations. That population increased by 7% between 2015 and 2016. If you look at, and I want to say the National County Commissioners Association called on all counties in the United States and Buncombe was one of the first to step up and recognize that your jails and detention centers are becoming deliverers of behavioral health services, becoming default behavioral health systems, and to look at nationally what that data tells us, that the rate of serious mental illness in the incarcerated population is 2 to 6 times higher than the general population. And nearly 70% of inmates nationally meet the criteria for substance abuse disorder. In our own Buncombe County, 51 jail beds a day are occupied by individuals receiving medical treatment for a serious mental illness. Recidivism rates for people with mental illness are twice as high as other defendants. We see the same individuals circle through. We often see the same criminal behaviors that tell us the current interventions are not working for those individuals and for our community. Nearly 800 inmates were monitored for substance withdrawal in our detention center in 2016. That's a 30% increase from the prior year. It impacts not only the detention center and the individual defendant, it impacts our community and it impacts families. And you just heard several hours of indication of that. But the majority of opiate users are women, and women are the fastest growing population in our jail. In Buncombe County, the number of women in our jail jumped nearly 30% between 2015 and 2016. Nationally, 95% of women who are incarcerated face trauma, whether that is as children or adults, but they bring to that experience their own trauma. Abuse in childhood, as you know, you've heard presentations on adverse childhood experience, is strongly, through multiple research elements, correlated with adult victimization, substance abuse, and criminal behavior. The rate of development and behavioral disorders in kids whose parents are incarcerated is significantly higher than children who are absent a parent as a result of divorce or death. We know that research tells us, and much of what Dr. Mullen just shared with you, is that there are social determinants of health. The conditions in which we are all born, grow, live, work, and age impact our health risk, and ultimately our death. Adverse childhood experiences shape physical and behavioral health throughout our lifetime and even impact our rate of death and our age of death. We have to approach this problem from a trauma-informed system. We have to, and national research tells us, we have to link criminal justice and the justice system with social networks, social programs, behavioral health programs, and social community supports. Every time an individual's charged, even with a misdemeanor, even without conviction, it carries lifelong impact. It can be barriers to housing. It's much of what we heard that are barriers in some of our communities. Employment, education, and financial assistance. That charge will follow that individual throughout their life and impact their ability to be a working, productive citizen. Buncombe's already a leader in this field. I know that Chief Deputy Matiabas is here, and as well as the sheriff, and their jail management programs are copied all over the nation. We're already a leader in our specialty courts, which are a reflection of the commitment of our judges, be that DWI court, drug court, family treatment court, or veterans court. We've built training and supported training and crisis intervention teams for all of our law enforcement entities. Teaching law enforcement how to interact with individuals with behavioral health keeps law enforcement safe and the consumer safe. We've built jail management systems where we have a group of individuals who look at, who track through our jails and emergency departments, are most often users of our ambulance system, who those same individuals are who track in and out. In the last year, Health and Human Services went out on an RFP and actually awarded it to Mission Health Partners that built a navigation system of those individuals. So we are building a system that will tell us every time those high-risk populations interact with an agency and what the cost or service associated with that is. That's how we build the ability to start measuring cost avoidance. We have a very strong pretrial program and are asking for the opportunity to grow that. It's a part of this presentation. Lisa mentioned earlier, we've addressed some of these wicked problems through 356 and through the Family Justice Center. This model is a national evidence-informed model, very similar to a Family Justice Center. What we need, and I will always remember Commissioner Belcher pointing this out to me in a conversation, is we often invest lots of money in services. Where we sometimes fail is building the connection, the coordination of those services, taking many fragmented services and pulling those pieces together and leveraging impact. That's particularly true when you're talking a judicial system and a health and human services behavioral health system. This is about building those links, addressing those disconnects. Always when we bring you a recommendation, it comes from evidence-based national models that have been proven to work other places. It's about coordinating your financial investment and our services. It's about being driven by data, and I'm going to talk about that in a minute. It's about smart partnerships, bringing together the talents all over our community to help leverage greater impact. We're outcome-focused, and we're always about how much cost can we avoid. How do we reinvest savings, and are we building a sustainable model? And we bring you what we believe tonight addresses all of that criteria. Our strategy is first and foremost to always protect our community. Public safety is always first. Our judges and our district attorney make decisions every day about public safety as they see individual defendants in their courtroom or charges. What this does is put more resources in their toolbox, more ability to have a comprehensive assessment of that individual's risks to the community, and make sure that when we divert people from incarceration or the judicial system, they're individuals who do not pose risk to our community. Rather, they're individuals who need connection to behavioral health and health services and programs. It's formalizing the coordination, much as we did in the Family Justice Center, and it's building a leadership team of these experts. It is the group that I introduced you to earlier who will make decisions about hiring the coordinator, about the benchmarks that we want to be measured against, about the program criteria. It's not a decision, it will not be left in the hands of any single agency. It's about bringing all that expertise to the table. We want to invest in system gaps. Those of you who met with court officials and have had the opportunity since those meetings to meet with court officials heard we miss the structure of a day reporting center, of formal case management supports, of supports directly tied to substance abuse and behavioral health issues. So it's investing in those gaps. So it provides a seamless system. And we provide the infrastructure support. The county's investment in this is planning and evaluation, business intelligence by building the dashboard and reporting out on the success of the program and providing the infrastructure. This is the proposed model, and I'm really going to flip to the next slide very quickly, but want to say, I get the 10-minute limit. I want to say this really is about building on the foundation of a strong, faith-based, and nonprofit safety net. It's about drawing those individuals who are served to our court system and making the connection back to those social supports you heard so much about earlier. What's new, what I'm actually standing up here to ask you for, is the formation of the Justice Resource Council, this oversight body of those judicial experts and leaders. A justice resource coordinator, much in the same way our Family Justice Center coordinator operates. A case management system that allows all those specialty courts and case managers to make electronic referrals to community services to get information back to share with the judges and the district attorney about how an individual complies with the services that they've been provided. A new investment or additional investment in pretrial services. Detention-based prosecution. That's about an assistant district attorney assigned directly to manage and look at every day who's in the jail. Do they have behavioral health issues? Do they have substance abuse issues? Are there appropriate community resources? And to be that one point of contact for the defense bar in the public defender's office in talking about how we might move forward in alternatives to incarceration, and a full-time victim witness legal assistant. Those are the new parts. All of those other components, you have a hand in funding. This is about improving the coordination of many things you already fund. What we expect to see is increased public safety and equity around justice. A more efficient system by building those electronic connections and providing that case management service. Elimination of duplication, a system that offers appropriate health and behavioral health treatment. A diversion of nonviolent offenders, which will reduce recidivism rates. If we can address the underlying behavioral health issue, we will address recidivism rates. Increased employment, this is about in this day reporting center, a full-time employment specialist who works not only with the individuals to help them move into job training and work, but works with employers to incentivize their willingness to hire individuals who've interacted with our court system. And most importantly, families and neighborhoods stay intact.
Ms. Stone, before you move on, can you back that slide up? So these goals... I'm sorry, that's it. That's okay. The slide. Expected results, okay? These goals are general in nature.
Yes.
There's no percentages associated with those, right?
Right. We're going to show you a dashboard that's about measuring the actual individual components of the program.
So might I suggest that, not tonight, but that there be... benchmarks, and it not just be a floating number. You know what I'm saying? That you know, you're coming back and reporting that, you know, it's reduced or it's changed by X percent. You know, wouldn't it be realistic for you to what your staff and others and the all those involved to set some numbers and to try to go after them? A goal tends to be hit. Or more often hit if it's very specific in nature. So just
we absolutely will identify specific numerical goals that will be reported out on, and we'll show you the tool for doing that. That's in a large part the role that Rachel Nygaard and Dr. Creighton will play.
Okay, thanks.
I appreciate you asking that question.
Yes, ma'am.
I think the drive, as I heard it from many commissioners who began looking at this issue, is realizing that you had a current capital plan that called for a detention facility expansion of $45 million. What we're asking you for tonight is targeted investments to delay or eliminate that need. A $547,000 annualized is request. It's a self-sustaining model in that we've identified the federal inmate revenues as a funding stream. So revenues that come into our jail because federal inmates are housed there being reinvested in our community with those individuals who cycle in and out of our jail. This is a very rough example of what a dashboard would look like, but what would actually happen is we customize the dashboard for all of our judicial partners so that every one of them could see every day how each of these unique diversion programs are being used, what the numbers served are and what the outcomes are, as well as measuring the impact in our jail population. Do we see a decrease in the number of individuals with behavioral health? These are not complete because we've not begun the programming component of that, but the judicial experts would actually be defining what they want to see measured on this dashboard that's available to them each and every day. These are citations and links of interest that take you back to this being a national model and that there is research that indicates these strategies can work, and I am happy to answer any questions, and more importantly, to direct your questions to the appropriate judicial expert.
Oh. So I have one question. Maybe this is for Dr. Green. If $45 million, do you know what the payment would be on that annually?
You could count on that payment being just a little over $4 million a year, but you also have to add to that the operating cost of somewhere between $1.5 million and $2 million. So you're looking at $5.5-6 million.
I don't think anybody up here has the stomach to want to say they want to fund a $45 million jail. But the payment is very real on that, and that's $8 million a year. And so if we can delay it 5 years, I mean, well, and hopefully maybe we can make it go away. Wouldn't that be wonderful? Would that not be amazing? Now, Sam, if you was with me or worked with me when I was in my previous job, I am a crazy goal person. I mean, I will set numbers that would drive you out of your mind, because a number, whether it's a sales number or whatever number it is, you know, is you don't know what's a good number till you break it. Then when you break it, somebody else breaks it, right? So that's why we've really got to challenge ourselves on what are these goals, you know, on reducing, you know, X, Y, or Z, and not being satisfied with the fact they're being reduced. I mean, we should set a crazy goal. Not be disappointed if we miss it, but be gratified in the process and what can happen. So, and that's what happens when it gets after 8 o'clock. I can get on it after 8 o'clock now. So, but anyhow, no. Thank you for the presentation, that was the only question that I had this time.
Thanks. I wanted to say thank you. Since we started this whole conversation, Judge Hill, Sheriff Duncan, Chief Matiabas, Public Defender's Office, all the judges, I know I have besieged you with questions, and I'm so grateful for the knowledge and the guidance that you give us. And $45 million, and but even past that, having someone go to jail and spend time there away from their family when we could have put alternatives in place. And again, so grateful to Dr. Creighton, to Rachel, to Mandy, to Lisa. I know we talk on the phone all the time. I call you. You probably look at the phone and say, I'm sorry again. But it has been an education, and I so appreciate all of what you do and the dedication. So I look forward to seeing what we can do.
Great.
I did want to be clear when you look at your budget amendment that the $547,000 annualized is for this new investment in resources. In addition, tied to this request is a $295,000 request for additional case managers assigned to our current pretrial program. Kim's staff works incredibly hard and are incredibly skilled, but they carry a caseload of 673. So her current case managers all have individual caseloads of between 150 and 180 defendants. And this is an opportunity, and I know Judge Hill has advocated strongly for this, to put additional resources, both additional electronic monitoring devices as well as additional case managers in the pretrial program, which is closely aligned with this model.
And within this, we'll placing social workers in the public defender's office, is that part of this, or is that part of your budget, or how does that work?
That is not something we've actually yet received a formal request for. We understand it's one of the best practices that the public defender's office has identified, so we haven't been able to talk to Dr. Green about a potential funding stream because we've not yet seen a proposal, but it is one of the models that you see nationally, is Lincoln. Again, that person who can help move defendants and connect them to neighborhood-based services and community-based services.
So am I reading the ordinance right that's in there? Is $228,000 of this funded by the jail revenues?
The jail revenues, our recommendation is that jail revenues cover the cost of this, both now and moving forward.
Are there any other questions for Mandy Stone now? I also wanted to ask Judge Hill if he would like to come forward and share any thoughts with us as well. I know he's been very involved in helping think through some of these ideas that we're discussing tonight. Thank you for being with us.
Well, thank you for having me. I just want to come and simply say thank you to the commissioners for at least rolling this around and giving it some consideration. I think this model does put us in the best position to identify people that judges realistically would feel comfortable letting out of jail if we know that we are putting them into resources that will help them. We can do it safely and have them monitored. It's not realistic to think that we're going to be able to get everybody out of jail. There are some people, they got to be locked up. But there are a lot of them with appropriate resources and monitoring, judges will feel very good about letting them out and trying to connect them to the appropriate services. Ms. Stone and her team have done an excellent job at structuring this in a way that I believe if we can get it in place, it will give us a very good chance of keeping you from having to spend that $45 million on a new facility. I think it will put us in a good position to monitor these incarcerated people and get the maximum number out into appropriate services once we can get this up and going.
Great, thank you. Todd Williams, our district attorney, would like to share a few comments as well.
Thank you, Chairman Newman. I've already said my piece. Didn't know that I was going to have an opportunity at this point in time, so I'll just ask that those comments.
Well, you don't have to repeat yourself now if you don't want to.
I'm not going to do that.
Or if you're like Commissioner Belcher after 8 o'clock, but we can get going.
I did want to address, actually, it's sort of ironic that was Commissioner Belcher that spoke up and asked me to be brief, because I wanted to respond to your, you know, crazy goals comment. And one of the things I neglected to mention in my earlier comments was that I would hope that the county would use its formidable communications arm to communicate to the public about the consequences, the collateral consequences, that contact with the criminal justice system that impairs people's ability to achieve their goals in the future. Because one of our biggest obstacles is we have the program in place and we offer it to folks, and the response is, can I just get a PJC, which is a conviction? Can I just plead guilty and pay my court costs and go home? And they're not interested in doing the extra work, which might include a substance abuse assessment and some classes, and get a dismissal, which then it doesn't foreclose their entry into the armed services, or they don't have to check that box that they've been convicted of something. So what we really need is we need a public, a PR, you know, education, I guess, campaign together with the rollout of this Justice Resource Center. And I neglected to mention that earlier. That's good. Crazy goals. I think we can achieve many of them with that foundation.
Could you share with us in a little more detail the work the victim witness assistant will do as part of this program structure?
Thanks for putting me on the spot on that one, because I don't have
after 8 o'clock. So there you go.
Yes.
For more information later, I just would
bring
the pieces together.
what comes immediately to mind is to move cases through the system, we have to run criminal records, we have to prepare documents, that position is not yet well defined, but we do foresee it to be, you know, useful in this enterprise in reducing, you know, jail population. So I will work on that. I'll do my homework.
Thank you.
We've got a copy of the job description we can send along for more information.
Great.
Great. Sure, yeah. Come on up.
Good evening. I'm Leanne Melton. I'm the Chief Public Defender for Buncombe County. I've been the Chief Public Defender since 2008. Came here as an Assistant Public Defender in 1996, so I've been doing this work for a little over 20 years now. And we do have a problem with mass incarceration in this nation, and I think this is a great step forward to work on that issue. And I want to thank each and every one of you for your public service and the time and the energy that you're putting into this. I'm very excited about this justice resource coordination. I think you have the ability to do a lot of good and to help a lot of people work on the issues of the disease of addiction, and also economically help the county's situation in terms of jail costs and also the economic costs of recidivism in Buncombe County. Again, I applaud you for that. I want to give a shout out to our supervised pretrial release office. I know that Kim Moretz is here, supervising over 600 individuals. That's more than our current jail population in the Buncombe County Jail right now. And they have a total of 9 full-time employees and 2 part-time employees to supervise those individuals. Individuals that are out pretrial, they have not been convicted of criminal offenses. They are just accused. And there are economic disadvantages for individuals who are poor and at disadvantage in our money bail system. And I think having our pretrial release supervision office and having a strong pretrial supervision office helps remedy some of those economic money bail issues. And just because you have the ability to pay a bond, you can get out of custody. But if you don't have the ability to make that bond, you can't. I think fully funding pretrial release is extremely important. I hope at a future date the commission, once I submit the proposal to Rachel Nygaard and Dr. Creighton about the social worker position that's funded in Mecklenburg County and what that social worker position does, I'd hope that this commission would also consider also funding positions in the Buncombe County Public Defender's Office. Again, I thank you for all your time and your energy and the good work that you're doing with this this coordination. Thank you.
Thank you. I think we'd like to go ahead and ask if there are any other public comments on this proposal. Sheriff Duncan, would you or anyone from your staff also like to add any comments?
And I'm going to be brief. I know
it's just take your time.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. No way. As we've talked tonight, we're at an exciting time. We really are. To turn the corner on some things and continue to do the things that have kind of set us apart as a county in leadership, in diversionary programs, jail diversion programs, and also programs within the jail. Commissioner Belcher talked about lofty goals. We're there.
Right.
And all honesty, the program that Mandy's rolling out, which I support 100%, I think we have to monitor, and we have to monitor it several ways. She started the presentation with public safety because I think the folks who empower us to do our jobs expect us to keep them safe, and we have to monitor and make sure that this in no way compromises their public safety, and we have to watch those numbers. Also, your jail right now is built for 604 inmates. Right now we're at 568, I believe, as of today is our number. So we're effectively full, because if you move those numbers about classification, in other words, you can't put serious offenders in with misdemeanor offenders, males in with females, and those sort of mixes. We're kind of effectively full. Now, we hold 100 federal inmates right now. We can do away with that, and the county has to decide that. But remember, that money funds your diversion program. So we are really threading the needle with how we're proposing to do. And remember, our projections on reducing inmate population are just that, the projections. I think they're going to work. We know that we're going to have better outcomes, but is it going to move those numbers to where we can manage what we're putting out there to do? So I don't want to be a Debbie Downer at the end of the evening. I support this. I think this is great. I know what we got from the Family Justice Center is more coordinated effort, like that coordinated community effort. We're going to get that more in the criminal justice system. I think we're going to have better outcomes, but we do need to monitor where we're going, not next year at budget time, but like monthly with the dashboard and see what we've got going on. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Any other members of the public who would like to comment? Okay, Jerry Rice.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. You know, the judge out here, he knows me from way back before he ever got here almost. And the others know me. One of the common questions that you hear from the judge when they get up in front of somebody, they'll say, how far did you go in school? Huh? How many years did you stay in school or whatever? If they build a prison system on the third grade education, this goes back to something Mr. Whiteside could identify with before anybody. When you got a school system that's not teaching and not doing their job and throwing the kids out right and left, and I've been to the juvenile justice system many times at court and DJJ, and I say to them, why in the name of God don't you put the responsibility back on the school? The school is responsible for educating these kids, not you. Now, I might be talking in tongues when I'm talking to you all about this, but yuns are failing a big problem here. Yuns are failing. Yuns got an F today. I want you to get an A later, but you got an F today. You cannot keep funding a school system that is sending these kids into this juvenile court system with this kind of education. Because we are paying, taxpayers, we are paying for the thing that I started with 29 years ago in advocating for education. Because the school system is throwing these kids out that they are dealing with right here. Now, if you want a little more history and a little more education in it, I can give it to you. Because these judges, these court officials, and these people on the street dealing with these what we call criminals are people that's come through Buncombe County education system, and this is where they end up at. They are dealing with the hand they're dealt. Whatever amount of money we got to deal with, think about it. If we don't get a handle on the education system right now that we got in the pipeline, this number is not even going to touch what we're going to do later. You got it. Thank you.
My name is Kathy Avery. I'm a nurse. I like to call myself embedded with a BIPA. And I guess you all know what a BIPA stands for now. I wasn't going to say anything, but I would love to help you guys not have to build another jail. That would be great. I did a survey that I've been working on for a couple of years that I am extremely proud of. It's not as scientific as some surveys, but I think it would do the purpose, and I certainly want to get it out for people to see. But one of the things that I learned in working with the community and working with the BIPA is that when you ask people, and my clients is where I got the idea to do the survey, and it's on the social determinants of health. And so if for those of you who don't know what all that includes, it's the jobs, your education, where you live, your health care, food security, there's a whole list. So what I started to do, since I'm working in community, especially housing, was to ask the people that I serve, do you even know what the social determinants of health and what health care and the justice system and all of us use to serve you? Do you even know what we're even talking about? They have no clue. So I thought one objective was to go out and tell them what we use to serve you. What do you think about that? What do you know about that? And so that was one of the objectives that I had. But one of the things that I learned that was so profound is a lot of my clients, I asked them, I said, you know, when you were young, what did you want to be when you grew up? When they were 10 years old, they could tell you what they wanted to be. All of you out here can. You just, you know, what do you want to be when you grow up? A lawyer, a doctor. You had something you wanted to be. By the time all these people, and this is all ages, by the time they were 12 years old, life had done slapped them down. You talk about trauma, and we're working with trauma. In those cases, everybody has already got hit with trauma, especially low-income and underserved populations. Trauma, they're on drugs, they've been raped, they're uneducated, they quit school. Where are they going? When we allow people to stop school at 16 years old, where are these people going? What is their future? And so I've seen these people up close. I've seen people on drugs, just getting off of drugs, no job prospects, and it is just the saddest thing I've ever seen. And what the second point in the survey that makes me cry is that 67% of the people finished high school, which is sad enough, but nobody, zero, had a four-year education of the people I surveyed. Some had some education higher than high school, but none have finished that, zero. People that didn't even finish high school was a large number. And I'm thinking, okay, what are we gonna do about that? And I think we talked about that already.
Thank you. All right. Seeing no other comments, I'm going to bring it back to the commission for discussion and motion.
I'm ready to make a motion.
Please do.
Ready to make a motion for the funding of the justice resource coordination effort, as well as do I need to do budget amendment 10?
Yes, sir, and the approval of the position.
And the approval of the position. So I think I got all three of them. So.
All right, that's budget amendment 10. Which is $228,226 in the associated staff positions. Is there a second?
Second.
Sorry. Seconded by Commissioner Presley. Further discussion?
I'd just like to take a moment to thank everyone who's worked on this and also just lift up one of the great strengths that I see in this proposal is the different disciplines that are coming together on this from the criminal defense perspective, the DA's perspective, the law enforcement perspective, HHS and behavioral health, and the community perspective. And I think part of what I heard you saying was this is important work and we should move forward with it, and there's much more work that we need to do. And I very much look forward to continuing to hear from the Public Defender's Office, the Sheriff's Department, DA's Office about what else we can be doing in our community to make sure that we don't need to build this jail and instead can be helping people live up to their fullest potential. So thank you all very much.
I have one thing to say.
Commissioner Fryer.
I want to thank Van, first of all. Then I want to thank Mr. Matiavis, because they've accepted 100 federal prisoners. That helps pay some more on our jail, and that's on the good side. We don't need to go over, and I think what Mandy and them's proposed is going to make it work, especially if we can use a little bit of the federal money that's coming in. So I just want to thank y'all for that side, working hard in the jail to keep your numbers down, but being able to work with the federals too. So thank you.
I'd like to echo that and say from a community standpoint and as a taxpayer, it's good to see our criminal justice community working to make life better for us in the future. When you look at the problems that are going on in counties across the country, I don't see them being proactive, but they're being reactive. And I think that's what's good, what I see here from our community. Judges, all of you, keep up the good work, because this is not only going to save us money, but it's going to make taxpayers out of people who we view now as tax takers. And one thing, too, since my friend Jerry used my name, I'll have to say before I shut up, is that, you know, I've worked for education, been a supporter all my life. But one thing I'll have to say, we cannot continue to use the schools and our educational system as scapegoats. Ladies and gentlemen, it takes a community to raise a child, and we've got to do that, and that's all we're talking about here, all of us doing our jobs to make these kids be successful citizens. And the schools cannot be mommy, daddy. They can't do all that. It'll take all of us working together. Thanks.
I just wanted to add on to what Commissioner Whiteside had said. Through the equity, through everything else we've learned, a child spends 6 hours a day at school, and let's talk about the first hour that child gets to school and what those teachers, non-certified employees, have to deal with to get that child to be comfortable, whether it's physical comfort or mental comfort. So we, many, many, many good people for many years have tackled the achievement gap. We need a much more holistic approach, and schools cannot be a punching bag for lack of achievement. It's on all of us, not just the schools.
Any other comments before we vote on the motion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? Great. Thank you all. We're going to keep things moving. We've got a grant projects ordinance, which has several different pieces to it, which Dr. Green will provide a quick overview on. And we just need one motion to approve the grants projects ordinance, which includes the different items, I believe. Is that right?
Well, we actually have three. Gary Higgins has the first one, if he wants to present that, and we'll need a motion on it. And then we have one from Kim Moretz and one from Van Duncan.
But aren't they all in the Fund 27 amendments?
Well, we can approve them all as one unless you want to know the details of them.
But it would just require one motion to approve all of them.
Yes.
Well, most of these are grants the county has received, so maybe just a very short explanation, and then we can have one motion to approve them as a group.
Okay.
This won't take long. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, the Soil and Water Conservation District has received a couple of grants, and so what we need to do is just get approval on our budget amendments. One of them is for the closure of some abandoned waste storage lagoons, and another one is for some of environmental education programs. The one for the lagoons is the budget amendment, both revenues and expenditures, $123,975, and the Pigeon River Fund grant for Envirothon and Camp Wild is $8,755. So, and no cost to the county. It's just be a budget amendment to get the revenue set up and the expenditures set up.
All right. So great. Thank you, Mr. Higgins.
So, could I make a motion to approve?
Second.
We have a motion and a second.
Next, we have Kim Moretz.
I think we've just shifted gears. I think we will just vote on each one of these. So so just hold one moment. So we'll just go ahead and vote on the first one. There's a motion and a second. Any questions from commissioners? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Great. Thank you. Ms. Moretz, thank you for being here.
I just wanted to tell you a little bit about the innovation grant that we're receiving. And we actually applied for the MacArthur Safety and Justice money a couple of years ago, which we didn't get chosen for, but they contacted us back and said, we'd like for you to apply in the second round. So we did that, and we received this innovation fund money. And what that's going to pay for is an innovative strategy for supervising defendants who are charged with domestic violence. And it's going to pay for two part-time field supervision coordinators that will be able to go out into the community and really have a lot of contact with these defendants, monitor that they're not having contact with the alleged victims, and make sure that they're complying with all their court-ordered conditions. And so that will pay for that. This grant will pay for those two positions. But I also just wanted to add that it's really an honor to get chosen in this process, because as a part of it, we get to participate in the Safety and Justice Challenge Network, which is 40 sites across the nation that have been chosen because they're doing very innovative things in their jurisdiction. And the MacArthur Foundation wants to support those jurisdictions and look at what they're doing and spread those innovative projects across the nation.
Thank you. Questions or motion?
I move to approve.
Second.
All right, there's a motion and a second to approve the budget amendment of $50,000 reflecting the grant. Any other comments or questions from the commission? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? All right, and I believe on the next item is the sheriff or someone from your staff commenting on this one. Thank you. The DWI Task Force.
Buncombe County Sheriff's Office and Asheville Police Department, actually it was an Asheville initiative, started the DWI Task Force several years ago. We're going into our fourth year of funding. And what this amendment simply does is it moves, we didn't realize whether or not the fourth year would be funded. So we asked the commissioners, and y'all have already approved the money to pay for the two positions that we've had in the DWI Task Force. What this simply does is move that funding to the grant side to make our match. It's no new monies, it's just moving it from one side to the other for the grants. The effectiveness of the task force, I would be just repeating Ann Fowler, Sergeant Ann Fowler's data. They've been extremely effective, and we've decided to stay in that, and the governor's highway safety, because of the effectiveness, has decided to fund us for another year going forward. Questions?
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
There's a motion and a second. Any other questions from the commission? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Thanks, Sheriff. And I believe that the budget amendment, Fund 10, that's for the same item, so that's taken care of through that. All right, I think we're good. All right, thank you. The next item on our agenda is an update from Asheville Buncombe Technical Community College on capital plans for the AB Tech campus.
Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, tonight I'd like to give you just a little bit of history on Article 46 sales tax and how we have yet on the AB Tech facilities. I want to remind you how we came to have Article 46. In 2007, we used to pay 5% or a little bit more than that of Medicaid expenses. So the state made a trade with the county. They took our Article 44 sales tax, which was a half cent, and took our Medicaid expense, which we thought was a great trade. It was our fastest growing expense in our budget. But they gave us the option then to have an Article 46 sales tax, quarter cent sales tax, approved by the public if we wanted to proceed with that. So after a few years, we did proceed with that. And on January the 18th of 2011, the board passed a resolution to conduct the referendum on Article 46. The referendum, the general statutes are very clear how the ballot has to read. It had to read that it would establish a local sales and use tax at the rate of 0.25%, in addition to all other state and local sales and use taxes. That's all you could put on the ballot. You couldn't put what you were going to use that sales tax for. So the commissioners at the time passed a resolution saying that they would use the sales tax, and I'm sorry, I don't have a... if we could go on to... Oh, thank you. the commissioners did pass a resolution saying they would use the sales tax for AB Tech capital projects, and it did. The quarter cent sales tax did pass. Here's the resolution that was passed. And the difference in a resolution and an ordinance is more like a law in the county. A resolution is passed without having to have a public hearing on it, and it can be changed at any point that you'd like to change it. So given that we were going to use the sales tax for AB Tech, we had an original plan that was drafted in the mid-2000s. AB Tech had long prepared, there had been several attempts to have a statewide bond. So there was an original plan that included new projects like Allied Health and a public safety classroom, renovations to things like the Elm and the Rhododendron building and the Coleman Students Center, and then some major maintenance like upfits at Inca or roads and sidewalks. The original list that came to us was an $80 million list. But when you have a new capital plan, this capital plan was several years old by the time we passed it. So when the new capital plan was developed and we started to take a look at what we really needed, there's several things that you have to look at when you're looking at a capital project. You're going to have a contract for an architect, a civil engineer. You're going to have soil and water tests that are done by different engineers. You're going to have a survey. There's going to be construction costs. There's going to be furniture, fixtures, and equipment. And often, if you're renovating a building, there could be some demolition. So you could have six or eight contracts, not just one contract, to move on with a building. So as we moved forward, and AB Tech had a chance to take a really close look at what they really needed, and they started to reevaluate their needs, several of their needs had changed. And it included acquisition of some additional property. It's a fairly landlocked piece of property, AB Tech is, if you look at it. A relocation of some facilities on the property, and some programming, some different programming for additional buildings. So what came out of where we stand today, instead of the original seven projects, we actually purchased a building that we refer to as 93 Victoria, and I think it's called the Robertson Building today. We paid $2.6 million for that. We went forward with an Allied Health building, although there were a lot of input on the design and the location of that building and the content of it. So we ended up with an Allied Health building, a multi-purpose building which will hold 800 people and can be broken into different rooms for different purposes, and a 650-space parking deck. In order to do the Allied Health building and the other buildings, we did have to take some structures down. We lost the Madonna building, which was the Madonna building was about 10,000 square feet. We had to take down the Pines building, which was about 24,000 square feet. We had to repurpose Hemlock. It had some issues. It had an indoor firing range, developed some lead problems in there. So we built the classroom building at the public safety training facility, cleaned up the Hemlock building, and it was repurposed for some of the programs that were in the Pines building. And we had a problem with a chiller at the Inca facility. And then we had some major maintenance. And that included things like some of the roads and sidewalks, we did build into our plan having to pay some additional maintenance costs on our buildings, new square footage, but we did have several changes to the original plan. So today, this board has adopted budgets that total $106 million for the AB Tech projects. That's done in several stages. With our construction, we always pass a reimbursement resolution. It's an Internal Revenue Code requirement to say if you spend any money, you have to pass the reimbursement resolution in order to be able to pay yourself back when you actually go borrow money. You don't know up front how much you're going to have to borrow because you haven't programmed the building. You haven't evaluated the site. We often pass an initial budget amendment. We're hoping that's the final budget amendment. It doesn't often prove to be. We have to have a public hearing on the financing of the projects. And then you have to approve certain large construction contracts. So here are the structures and where we are today. We bought the 93 Victoria building. It we approved the budget for that on March the 20th of 2012, approved the financing in May of 2012, and approved the purchase of, in June of 12. It's a $2.6 million budget. And all the votes on these were unanimous votes, but this was done when we still had a five-member board, so it was a 5-0 vote. There was a point in time when we started taking a look at the Allied Health building that we determined that we had some unhappiness in the neighborhood. We might want to look at how and where we were sitting this property. So we had a group of trustees who sat down and worked with us looking at the property to say, what's the better structure? Where do we need to locate this building, and how do we need a parking deck? We had some presentations before the Board of Trustees. So we ended up with an Allied Health building that includes 169,000 square feet. It has 22 classrooms, 14 labs. It has 5 floors. The construction began in February of 12, and the building is now complete. The budget amendment was approved in March of 2012. The financing was approved in January of 2014, and the budget for the building was just over $41 million. Instead of having an auditorium inside the Allied Health building, we opted to go with a multi-purpose building that stands alone on the property. The budget for that building was approved in August of 13. The financing was approved in January of 14. It is a $7.5 million budget. It's 26,000 square feet. It's meeting space that will seat up to 800. It has a catering kitchen and a lobby area. If you haven't been in the building, it's a very nice facility where you can have a significant portion of your meeting out in the lobby area. We located this building right next to a parking deck. One of the problems we heard about a lot from the students was that parking was a challenge on the property. So this is a 652-space building, parking deck. It's located adjacent to the multi-purpose building that you just saw. It's next to this building. That budget amendment was adopted in May of 2013. The financing was approved in January of 2014. It is a $15 million budget, and the deck is complete, and we are now parking in that deck. At the same time we were doing this, like I said, we had some issues with the Hemlock building when we had to clear that building, and we built a 40,000 square foot, two-story classroom building at the public safety training facility, which is down at the old landfill. It includes 4 EMS labs, locker rooms, offices, and break rooms. The budget amendment was approved in March of 12, and the financing was approved in January of 14. Since everything out of Hemlock was moved here, Hemlock was renovated and repurposed. It was a 33,500 square foot building. It was repurposed to hold many of the programs that were in the Pines building. There were other projects that we did. We just had a chiller issue at the Inca campus, and we had to replace that chiller. The chiller cost $630,000. It was considered fairly much an emergency to get it replaced. We did approve it in March of, the budget amendment was approved in March of 12, and it was included in the January 14 financing. And I think that's the only major renovation we've made at the Inca campus with this money. When we put the bond model together, we knew that there would be maintenance costs. And maintenance costs we don't finance. We pay for with cash because these are really, while they may extend the life of some facilities, these just didn't rise to that level. So this include, there were 5 different budget amendments that started in July of 14, one in September of 14, November of 14, March of 15, and October of 16. These were a lot for roads and sidewalks. We did have some capitalized interest. We had to run some fiber on the campus in order to connect the new buildings. And there were some retaining walls that we had to address as we went through the project. So all of these were approved by the board and paid. And these were not financed. They were paid for with cash. We have reached a point, and this is where we end at our last meeting. There is a new structure proposed in, on October of 15 and again in October of 16, you passed two budget amendments that take the budget to this, for this building, to $27 million. It's a 99,000 square foot building. We have to date spent $2.2 million. And you asked us at the last meeting not to spend any more, just to stop until we could get a report back to you on where we stood. We did pass the reimbursement resolution on this one in December of 15, the first budget amendment for $7 million in October of 15, and the next budget amendment for $20 million in October of 16. There's a couple of things that, before I transition, and Dr. King gives you some additional information on this building. When we had our retreat last week, one of the things we talked about was some information we had on jobs from Nathan Ramsey, who's the executive director of our Workforce Development Board. I have asked Nathan if he will come at our next meeting on the 7th of March to talk to us about the jobs, whether the numbers... 2 months ago, the numbers were 11,000 jobs that were available in our region. It's a four-county region. But whether they're 10,000 or 11,000, we need to know what those jobs are, what kind of training it takes for those jobs. And we have people who are willing and ready to go to work, so it's how do we get them from willing and ready to go to work to prepared and working. So I have asked Mr. Ramsey if he will be here, and he has agreed to be here on the 7th of March, and in the county manager's report give us an update on where we are with employment needs in our community. We have not spent any more money since we were here the last time. We have invested $2.2 million. The bids are in on this arts and science building, but that's where we stand historically. That's how we got from where we started with the Article 46 to where we are today, and Dr. King is prepared to share with you where we'd like to go and how we'd like to go forward, unless you have some questions for me right now.
I don't see any initial questions, so let's keep it moving ahead.
Good evening. Probably more appropriate to say good night. I appreciate the opportunity to appear before you tonight on behalf of AB Tech. And I also want to recognize a few of our people who are here. The first two rows here stuck with me. Our trustees, we had seven here in total, came and went as the evening progressed. but I do want to recognize Mandy Stone over here and Commissioner Fryer, who are on our Board of Trustees, and I appreciate your work with us. You may not realize it, but AB Tech is the largest higher education institution in Western North Carolina. We currently serve about 23,000 students a year through our various academic and continuing education programs. We offer more than 120 degrees, that's a two-year program, diplomas, that's a one-year program, and certificates, that's a grouping of courses not leading to an actual degree or diploma, designed to meet the needs of our students, whether they plan to transfer to a university or get specific skills from the college for workforce development. Our students range in age from high school in dual enrollment programs. There are about 1,700 dual enrolled students at our college right now, or adults who are with us for retraining. While we designate services, while our designated service area is Buncombe and Madison County, AB Tech students come from throughout Western North Carolina, and as Asheville becomes more popular from outside the state. You see our graduates in virtually every employment. They are your police officers, your nurses, your waiters, your chefs, auto mechanics. I heard about auto mechanics earlier tonight. We have lots of those ready for jobs. Computer programmers, engineers, airline pilots, and many, many more. I'm here representing nearly 340,000 people who have earned degrees or taken courses at AB Tech, and more than 1,000 AB Tech employees at five various facilities. You just heard from Dr. Green about the construction and acquisition of facilities since 2012. We're grateful for the support of this commission and the public in meeting the needs of our students and employers who depend upon us for education and training. Now I'd like to tell you more about where we currently stand in terms of the college's growth and the facilities we need for the future. Based on statewide economic impact studies conducted in 2014 as part of the Connect NC bond referendum, AB Tech's collective economic impact in Western North Carolina is a combined $356.7 million, which is the equivalent of 8,325 new jobs. This information was calculated by the Economic Modeling Specialist International, EMSI, for a study using 2012-2013 data. The current numbers are obviously much larger. During the year of the EMSI study, $38 million was allocated by state and local taxpayers to support AB Tech. EMSI found that the college provided $4.20 return on every $1 invested. Those are not our figures. Those came to the state from EMSI. The red line on this chart represents Buncombe County population growth from 1960 through projected growth of 2030. The blue bar represents AB Tech's enrollment from the first year of operation in 1960 to 2015. As you can see, AB Tech's enrollment has closely followed the county's growth, and we fully expect for it to continue. The bump you see in 2010 occurred during the height of the recession, when colleges nationwide experienced historically high enrollment due to the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act of 2009, which provided retraining funds for laid-off employees. This chart represents assignable academic footage per full-time equivalent student. This is important because construction of new facilities is based on assignable square footage for academic use, which only includes space used for academic instruction and instructional support. The blue line represents AB Tech. The red line represents the North Carolina Community College System. As you can see, AB Tech's average currently falls roughly 40% below the system average, although we are among the top 10 in size of the 58 community colleges. 2 years ago, Buncombe County commissioned a master facilities plan for AB Tech. After an extensive process, the plan recommended a host of construction, renovation, and other capital improvements, and assigned them to four priority levels. We'll not discuss priority four, since those projects are unlikely to be undertaken at any time in the future. Priority one projects are represented by this slide. The two key takeaways are the recommendation to renovate the rhododendron building, which has now been demolished, and to construct a south campus as a new home for our displaced ANCA programs. This slide represents priority two projects. This category includes the renovation of the Ivy Building, which is now being covered by Connect NC bond funds allocated for smaller renovations and repairs. Ivy is not suitable for most instruction, and it will therefore be used as office space and a public meeting facility. And then, instead of demolishing the Poplar Building, we also are using Connect NC bond money, and we got $5.4 million from that source, to renovate it for use by continuing education classes that were displaced from previous locations. The other two projects mentioned here do not impact instructional space. This slide represents priority three projects. The only project currently under discussion in this category is the Craft Beverage Institute. At the time of the study, it was assumed that the college would retain the Inca property, so the construction of this building was not deemed urgent. However, the Craft Beverage Institute will be displaced now that it's been decided to sell the Inca campus. Finding it and the Small Business Center and the incubator, which are housed out there at Inca, a new home, have become a higher priority. One of the greatest changes since the original master plan was produced is the loss of the Rhododendron Building, which was demolished last year at the request of the county after engineers deemed the building's renovation to be more expensive than new construction. This building was to be the home of our engineering programs. This photograph depicts the massive size of the two buildings that we're losing at Inca. In addition to the continuing education and emergency services programs already moved from the Haynes Building, which is on the right, we are now faced with finding new homes for the three programs I just mentioned, which are located in the building on the left. It is home, that building on the left is home to the Craft Beverage Institute, the Small Business Center, and the Business Incubation Programs, which currently house 20 incubating small businesses. 20 small businesses. Here's an early design of the new Arts and Sciences Engineering Building approved by this body last October. While it will be a wonderful addition to the college, it is important to note that it is 99,000 square feet, which is 17,000 square feet less than had we renovated Rhododendron and Elm. These are programs added since 2012. These programs weren't considered as needing a home back when the master facility study was done. These significant programs were not included in the projection for future growth during the planning process leading up to the master facilities plan. These programs trained between 2015 and 2017 an additional 300 students at the campus. This is a list of proposed programs. And they are, the list essentially is fueled by public demand from students and employers. As a community college, we are constantly evaluating the needs of the community in terms of training and employment. The list ranges from barbering. If you want to become a barber, you have to go all the way to Winston-Salem to get training today. To food service, to avionics, to physical therapy, to future programs requested already by Mission Hospital. You'll note that all of these are workforce development programs. By that I mean these are not university transferable programs. The intent of them is to get the graduate a job in that field. This slide represents a basic construction plan to meet the college's immediate needs. It includes constructing the Arts and Sciences and Engineering building we've been discussing, completing the fifth floor of the Ferguson Center for Allied Health and Workforce Development for two new Allied Health programs, renovating Elm and Birch to house the ANCA programs, cosmetology, and the Buncombe County early and middle colleges. Those are high school programs from Buncombe County Schools. And renovating the first floor of the Sycamore building for physics. Sycamore is our science building, and physics would be put in there. This plan would meet immediate needs, but it raises several concerns. The construction process would take more time and potentially be more expensive. The sale of the ANCA property would be delayed. And most concerning, there would be no room for future growth, including that long list of programs that I just showed you. This is an outline of what we believe would be an optimal plan for the future growth of the college. First, we would proceed on schedule with the construction of the Arts and Sciences Engineering Building. Second, we would finish the fifth floor of the Ferguson Center for Allied Health and Workforce Development. Third, we would construct a new building on the Asheville campus to house our three ANCA programs and future programs. And as planned, we would sell the ANCA property and, with trustees' approval, apply the proceeds of that sale to the renovation of the Elm, Birch, and Sycamore buildings. We believe this optimal plan has several good points to it. It will be quicker and ultimately less expensive. It will provide buildings with enhanced efficiency and technology, which ultimately will save money over the life of the buildings. It will provide enhanced space for the early college and middle college. And lastly, this plan will provide for new room for future growth. Ladies and gentlemen, you will note that both of these plans call for the construction of the Arts and Sciences Engineering Building as approved by AB Tech trustees last April the 4th and again on February the 9th of this year. Therefore, we recommend that you reaffirm the vote of this commission of last October and proceed with this building project. We do not ask for any action presently on the remaining elements of the basic or optimal plans. We are not here for those projects. We are only here to ask you for that Arts and Sciences Engineering Building. Buncombe and Madison counties have one of the best community colleges in North Carolina, as well as a national leader in the community college movement. We ask you to support us by maintaining the standard of construction for these buildings. I thank you, and I'll take any questions you might have.
Thank you. Questions?
Yeah, I've got the program's added since 2012.
Can you bring that back up over here?
You can now because I turned it on. How's that? It's amazing. Health and fitness science, occupational therapy assistants, central sterile processing. I have no clue what the last one is.
Central sterile processing is cleaning up the equipment that the surgeon has used so that contamination doesn't.
Okay, that was my guess.
Patient to another one.
My guess was something close to that.
And that's a certificate program, by the way. Okay, two or three, four courses.
So not to interrupt you, but my question is that's 67. Program that's at 67 enrollment. Why would those not be housed in the Allied Health Building?
The The Central Sterile Processing Program is in the Allied Health Building.
Okay.
I'm looking for the list now so I can, yeah, it is in that building.
About to pause.
Occupational Therapy Assistant is also in the Allied Health
okay.
Building. The others are not.
Health and Fitness Science isn't?
It's more of a PE kind of activity. It needs to be over by the gymnasium, and so it has taken some space in the present Elm Building.
Right. Okay. That's all I have right now.
Okay.
I have some questions. So we just heard a very compelling presentation where we from Dr. Mullen and Tom DeVeet, that within the African-American community, there's 17% unemployment. Mm-hmm. So the questions I have are, one, what are AB Tech's diversity numbers, faculty and students? And also, what is a plan, or has there been a plan for specific job training to help our community remedy 17% unemployment?
I can't deal tonight with the question about employees. I don't have those numbers with me, but I do have these numbers regarding the student body. In 2015-2016, our service area, and remember that's Madison and Buncombe counties, our service area had 15.6% minority students, minority population, beg your pardon. AB Tech during that same period in curriculum programs had 17.8% minority students, and in our continuing education area 17.2%. So we were doing better than the service area minority population. This year the service area minority population is also 15.6%. We've gone up to 18.1% in curriculum and 18.0. Now let me make this statement right now. I am not satisfied with our minority enrollment. I certainly want to see our minority enrollment go up. And as I listened to what was said this evening here, I felt compelled to see that we do more and more to bring in minority students. We are trying to do that, but I can tell you statistically right now we are above the minority population in both our curriculum and our Con Ed areas.
Kay.
Go ahead.
I have a question.
Yeah.
I hear your minority numbers, but let's break it down. What's your number of African-American students? Because we were talking about 17% mm-hmm. unemployment in the African-American community.
Okay, I was not talking about unemployment numbers. I was talking about minority representation.
Well, no, I'm trying to equate that to training. But how many African-American students do you have on campus?
Our African-American population as identified by the students. Now, a lot of students, this is a self-identification.
Oh, I understand.
Thing.
Yeah,
students I've been there. Don't identify, but they're identified as 6% of that 17 that I mentioned.
Wow.
6%.
Thanks. 6%.
And recently, I think you had a position of a diversity officer, and recently that position was eliminated?
No, ma'am. What we did was, the position was not fully, it was not working to an optimum benefit, exclusively working for minority recruiting. And so we moved it into the general general recruiting category, and it had an emphasis on it for minority recruiting. The woman who was in the position moved from exclusively recruiting minorities into a more general position with emphasis on minorities. And then she resigned. The position is being refilled, by the way.
Okay.
So I have one other question. I was involved, as you remember, helping the Humane Alliance establish a training program for people that wanted to work in the animal field.
Mm-hmm. I remember.
The vet tech program takes 2 years to complete.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of individuals who are interested in working can't take 2 years to dedicate.
Right.
So the Humane Alliance, which is now affiliated with the ASPCA, had a program of 12 weeks for very much the same pay rate as someone would have to get a vet tech degree.
Mm-hmm.
The ASPCA, the Humane Alliance, is nationally accredited as a training institution. And frankly, I know the program is now ongoing, but it was a long ordeal met with much resistance.
Mm-hmm.
So that was my experience with that very small program, but it was disheartening to me because I think we all share the fact we want people to get skills, but more than that, we want people to get good jobs. And it was, you know, I was glad the Humane Alliance persevered because, you know, the program has individuals in it now. They're from 18 to 65.
Mm-hmm.
But had they not persevered, it never would have happened. So I guess my question is, and then I'm done, is this typically what happens? People bring new ideas in job training. Luckily, they are a very strong organization, but this was not easy. It was climbing a big hill to give people job training.
Yeah. I would say that's not typical. In fact, I would tell you that we go out looking for opportunities. We're working with Buncombe County Schools right now to take over the certified nursing assistant training for the school system. That was our idea, to get that training done by AB Tech rather than by the school system. I think I can probably give you as many examples of us going looking to help with training and finding that sweet spot where we can give the training as you can with that one experience that you had with us.
I've got a couple of questions. understanding that the immediate request is to move forward with the arts and science engineering building, on the two different scenarios, the basic plan for intermediate needs and then the optimal plan for future growth, which are pretty similar but have slight differences, I'd like to understand what the cost would be if, you know, for each of those different scenarios, and also the timing that AB Tech envisions for the other projects besides the arts and science engineering building under those two different scenarios.
We don't have prices for the projects. I can tell you what was in the master facilities plan of 2015. For example, the Elm renovation was going to be, I believe it was $9 million. The rhododendron renovation was going to be $7 million, which was not spent on that project. There was another aspect of the timeline. We won't be doing any of these projects anytime soon, with the exception of the Arts and Sciences Engineering Building. I would expect that to do either one of those plans would take a minimum of 5 years. One of them longer.
To build the
basic one would take longer because some things can't be moved into the new space until the new space is renovated, so it would take more time. The optimal plan that would call for a second new building would be quicker because that construction could start earlier, but I would say a minimum of 5 years.
To build out the projects under either
absolutely.
Of the two scenarios?
Absolutely.
So tell me about the multi-purpose building. I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
Probably had more.
No, that's all for now.
Mm-hmm. The multi-purpose building, is that being – how? Tell me about the utilization of that building now.
Well, you may have heard that Mission Hospital gave us $1 million over 5 years for the naming rights of the building. And they will have those naming rights for 10 years. And at the end of 10 years, they'll either re-up with another $1 million or their name will come off the building. Mission uses the building probably 3 to 5 times a month. 5 would be a gracious number. It's more like 3, sometimes 4 times a month. We use it ourselves a great deal when they are not using it, although, to be honest with you, I've given them the highest priority on the use of the building. And then we rent it. We're doing a program, we believe, in April. We had a contract has not been signed yet with a nationally known speaker who will be coming in on African-American minority issues. So we use the building a great deal. Probably the most underutilized thing at this point, if that's what you're thinking of, is the parking garage. The top three floors of the 6th floor parking garage aren't as well used as the bottom floors are. That will change when the engineering and arts and sciences building is constructed behind the parking garage in a parking lot. All those cars that are parking in that lot presently are going to move into the garage, and I have every reason to believe the garage will be filled once the engineering building is engineering arts and sciences building is undertaken.
So when we approved the building of the parking deck, the reason for that was to remember it's after 8 o'clock, so my mind's kind of so
after nine.
It is after nine, so I'm supposed to be in the bed. But the reason for that was that there's not a lot of there's an awful lot of property being used for parking, and so the reason for approving that was that parking would be consolidated from whatever areas. I don't know how you do it, but so that's not being used. Now, the reason I'm asking the question is that I am not disappointed in anything that AB Tech is doing. You guys are doing a great job. You're a great facility. You know, this is about would like, you know, reports on how those buildings are being used and,
sure.
You know, are they being used efficiently and so on. So that's why I'm asking. So,
Commissioner Whitesides.
Well, I'd like to start by saying, Dr. King, you know, my family, we've lived there next to AB Tech since 1968 when Mom and Dad built there, and they were only 10 years old. I've lived there since I moved back with the bank, since 1970. And I've observed Buncombe Tech. I can name all the buildings, tell you when they were built and all. But let me give you my concerns, not only as a commissioner, but as a taxpayer. I am probably one of the most conservative people you'll see when it comes to being a fiscal conservative from my 40 years in banking. So therefore, I'm concerned about my tax money, too. When I look at all the parking spaces you have at Buncombe Tech, that's in the peak time of the day because I walk over there a lot. Not only is the parking building not full, but the parking lots behind over there are not full. And my concern is, how much space do you have now that's empty on campus?
Classrooms.
Now, you mentioned the 5th floor of the Allied Health Building. What happens to the half of the 4th floor that's not finished?
The 4th floor has been finished. We used a gift from the Fergusons last year to finish the 4th floor. The 5th floor is shell space. It is not finished. We do have plans to start two new Allied Health programs, one of which would be physical therapy assistant. And we would put that program up on that 5th floor if the 5th floor was finished. But remember, I'm not asking for that.
Yeah, right. Well, how much other space do you have on campus?
I'm not sure I can answer that. How much unutilized space?
Right.
Well, a lot of our space is dedicated, and probably the best example to give you is something like the kitchens in culinary or the labs in medical laboratory technology. These rooms are dedicated, and they are not used for general education classes like an accounting class. So you can come through the buildings periodically and not see students in the building. They may be out on clinicals, or they may be in some other area. It's very difficult to say what rooms are not utilized. What I can tell you is the Engineering Arts and Sciences building is an entirely different animal. Unique to our college, it will teach every single student who's seeking a degree. They have to take math, they have to take English, they have to take humanities, one humanities class, and they have to take social sciences. Whether they're in nursing or medical lab technology or surge tech, they all have to take those classes. That's a requirement of our accrediting agency. And so those students will all take those classes in the new Arts and Sciences Engineering building. Believe me, the Arts and Sciences Engineering building is not just for transfer students. Most of our demographic is about 45% of the students are transfer, but 55% of our students are in the kinds of programs that lead to workforce jobs, and those are the people who are will be using this new building along with the university transfer students. Then there's that large group of students in those applied science workforce programs who need courses like anatomy and physiology or physics for their program. Physics for sonography comes to mind. Those classes all would be taught in this new Arts and Sciences Engineering building. Can't tell you exactly how much space is not utilized because a college campus is not utilized the way a high school is from 8 to 3 in the afternoon. What I can tell you is we have peak periods when we can't find a classroom for a course, and so we have to put that course out in a less popular time. Remember, we're like everybody else. We work on supply and demand, and when the public demands classes from 9 to noon or 9 to 1, that's when we try to hold them. And in those hours, we're pretty full. But then we'll have other sections at other times to use the facilities also.
Okay.
Other questions? Commissioner Fryer?
I have some questions. This is hard because I'm wearing two hats. I love the school, but I love the county people too. I have a PowerPoint, if you please put it up. As a businessman for 34 years, I figured out that we're playing a bad game of hide and seek. Hold on just a second. I'm looking here, I've looked at this whole agenda that Ms. Green has put forward. And on July the 1st, I don't see anything far as funding into the maintenance. September the 2nd, we funded $902,425 on the consent agenda. November the 18th, 2014, a few months after the September deal, we funded $2,169,523 in the consent agenda. March 3rd, 2015, we put $716,400 into whatever out of the consent agenda. And then $100,000 on October the 18th for whatever is called major maintenance. I got a number, it even shows up on another thing. It's $5,700,000. But I add all these up, and I can only come up with $3,888,348. And another thing as part of this, and then I'll go through the rest of this, is December the 15th, December 1, 2015, we approved $7 million for a new rhododendron. It was backed up in the consent agenda, as 14th on the consent agenda, on October the 6th, 2015. 2018 on consent agenda, we supposedly, and did probably, approve $20,100,000 because they dropped to $7 million and bumped it to $27 million. I'm looking at one, still hold that, but I'm looking at the part here. This was an election, and it was won by very little, a very small number. It was paid for, because I have a check, by AB Tech, $89,900. If we had put it in a county election, it wouldn't cost AB Tech 10 cents. But we didn't. So that's, you know, here and there now. But what it is, let's go again. It's our responsibility to everyone of us commissioners to understand where the money is coming from and going to. Next slide. Let's take a look at where we've been, what we've been given. Slide. Ooh, I have to look at my paper now. The top one is, yes, we did buy Victoria for $2.6 million. This was the original approved agenda that we had. We did do sidewalks for $1.8 million. But if you look at Victoria, we gained 14,488 square feet of room. Allied Health Building was approved for $52 million. It was completed. They only used 41,200 and whatever thousand, but I thought it was $38 million because that's basically what I ran my race on. But that's 169,000 square feet of more space. Coleman Student Center, not complete, $2.5 million, not a dime spent. And that's sitting there, you know, it's I'm not going to count that. But you look at the uplift, you know, property for sale at Inca, we spent $630,000 on chillers at Inca. So that moved $5 million some dollars back. You go down to Rhododendron. It's torn down. So it was $3 million originally figured for it in this budget. It cost $500,000 to tear it down. Elm Building, $8.872 million was figured for it. That comes to $83,870 some dollars. We only spent $53 million. So that left us a reserve in that $80 million of $30 million. But go to the next slide, please. But look here. Non-adopted, when this was put through, was a parking deck, which cost $15 million. And a multipurpose building, $7.5 million, that was not approved. So that comes up to $22.5 million. We gained 26,000 square feet by putting the multipurpose building in. That gives us a total, yeah, we lost some square footage over there, but that gives us another total of 249,488 square feet of classrooms. So we got to take that $30 million that we had left and subtract that 22.5 from it. Because we need to, you know, that we built something that wasn't really on the agenda. So now we've only got $7,505 left. Next slide, please. But we're not done yet. Coleman Student Center, not started, $2.5 million was proposed for it. M building, not started. We got a fictitious number from that group that came out there for $17 million on M building. That was a year after this was put forward. So I'm saying it's $8,007,000. But then we get into major maintenance. There's another $5,747,000 that was hidden. Couldn't find it. Now I found it today. It's all on the consent agenda. So let's look at the next numbers. Where are we now? Let's do the math. $11,372,000 for Coleman and M, not spent yet, but promised. Well, you can't promise some, so we've got it promised. So let's take that $5 million that I didn't know that we spent on major maintenance. Now that comes to $17,199,005. Finally, you take $17,199,000 and you subtract what we got left to $7,500,000. So that puts us at a deficit right now, before we even talk about the other building, at $9,613,594. Next slide, please. But we're not done yet. October 18th, 2016, $27 million for an art science building was added to a consent agenda. Well, in that consent agenda, a building was added that everybody's asked me about. Mr. Creighton stood up before us right there and said that he's going to redo AM for $7 million, and he asked for it. I said $3 million, and he said $7 million. I said, tear it down, because, you know, we can build another building for $7 million, because we did down at the Fire Training Center. That would have been 40,000 square feet. We'd have lost 7,000 square feet. So there was $7 million approved for that. Then it came back again. But now it comes back at $27 million. I missed it. I blame myself. I flat missed it. But because I didn't have any clue that was going to build a building that big. Next slide, please. So you take the $9 million, which is over budget before the building, you take the $27 million for the arts and science building, that gives us a deficit right now of $36,613,594. That would be 35% out of budget at the present time, over budget if we approve it. AB Tech still would like to have one more new building in the process for the brewery, because you told me that yourself, standing in your office. So how much more money are we looking at? And we're right. We've got 38,000 square feet on the fifth floor of a building that nobody wants to build out right now. They want to hold it for 4 or 5 years. That's my problem, is looking at these numbers. That's my problem. Next slide, please. These items are hidden, and we had to seek them out. Next slide. By having these big items, we as commissioners are being kept from doing our job for the people whose money it is now and don't have a chance to seek it, to speak out. Well, that's not right. $27 million building should have never been put on a consent agenda. Next slide. One last thing. Allied Healthcare building, shed. Saw it the other day. Is this worth $50,000 or $72,000? Take a guess. That's $50,000. So how are we spending our money? Next slide. Too much hide and seek. The taxpayers deserve to know what's what. Verify where the money is coming from. Verify where the money is going and what's been spent. That was approved. How much we have left. I'm done.
All right. Any other questions?
So it's 25 of 9, or 10. I'd like to make a motion that we continue this discussion, because obviously every single one of us that's spoken has lots and lots of questions. And as far as the figures, I'm more confused than ever. So I'd like to make a motion that we continue this until we can get more answers to all the questions that have been posed.
I second.
There's a motion and a second, and for clarification, is the proposal to continue this to our next county commission meeting?
I am not going to be at the next county commission meeting, and I understand there's some questions about bids and deadlines.
Right. So I would I mean, it's great to, I mean, obviously these are important, really important questions for the community and AB Tech that we need to make decisions on. So I'm sorry that you're not going to be at the next meeting, but I think if we're not going to make decisions this evening, I think we do need to continue this at our next county commission meeting. So that would be my request, is that we do, it is late, and I do hope that we, you know, if the people do have other questions to answer, you know, the whole reason for having the meeting tonight, there are a lot of different pieces to this, and so we wanted to have a chance to have a full and open discussion and make sure people can get all the questions answered. I realize it is late, so at some point, you know, we may not be doing our best work, but anyway, I would suggest we do continue it to the next meeting, if that's okay with the maker of the motion.
What is the people that have made the bids need answers by a certain point?
That's right.
So
there's a specific bid that's been made for the Arts and Science building, and if we do not make a decision at the next meeting, that bid would no longer be valid.
So I would say that my concern is not the bid. My concern is when I first looked at the original plan for AB Tech, there was a master plan. It was very clear. And for me, there's so many. This is just not clear for me at all. I mean, I got a priority one, a priority two, a priority three, an optimal plan, a basic plan, you know, and I'm, you know, and that's very difficult. That's very difficult to process.
Well, I agree there's a lot of pieces to this, but these questions need to be answered. So I think if we're not gonna have time to do it tonight, we should resume this discussion at our next business meeting to continue to make progress on this and move towards whatever the answer is, making decisions on it.
And I will put that in my motion, and I can call into that meeting.
Okay. Yeah. Great. That'd be great.
But I do hope that our questions are answered directly, specifically, and clearly.
Well, I wonder if I could ask that they be given to me, and I'll make sure that we have a prepared answer. For example, I wasn't prepared tonight to let you know the minority representation in the employee category, but I certainly can get that number for you if that's a number that's of interest. So, you know, I need the questions, and I'll be glad to answer them.
I think I'd like to hear a short answer to what is being addressed directly, not spinning around conversations, but what's the specific plan for 17% unemployment in the African American community? That would be one. But I'll email you.
Do you have a question? All right. So yeah, I would also ask that there are other questions, since there's not a lot of time between now and the next meeting. Let's make sure, if there's no other questions tonight, I mean, people are saying they have a lot of questions, but I'm not hearing other questions. So if you do have other questions, I think you need to develop that list, and we need to provide them to AB Tech so that you can get answers on them. And so let's and if there are additional things the commission needs to do over the next 2 weeks to, you know, feel like everyone's done their homework on this, no pun intended, you know, done your due diligence on this, let's really focus on this. So if we need to, we had a lunch out at AB Tech a couple weeks ago to get further educated on this. If there are other site visits that are needed to look at some of the buildings that need to be, that are proposed for renovation, or some of the sites where there's new construction proposed, I would just ask that we all focus on these questions and to make an informed decision. So let's take it up at the next meeting, and if people feel fully prepared there, we can make answers, or we can make decisions. If there's still additional questions, then we can address that at that time.
And Chairman, I would not be opposed to a session similar to what we had recently, where we were, you know, we had our planning session. I mean, I wouldn't be opposed to sitting in a room with charts all over the place, information all over the place, you know, the plans and visuals, and I mean, you know, AB Tech's important to the community. I mean, I wouldn't be opposed to that at all. Okay. You know, and you can make it a public meeting and do whatever, but it's difficult. It's, and really, if, you know, 9 o'clock, 9:45, you know, we joke about that. It really doesn't matter. I mean, we'd be here until 12 o'clock. That really doesn't matter. What matters is making a good decision. And, we don't have to do that. We don't have to do that under the pressure of time or a bid. We don't. I mean, we can make a good decision, and that's where I'm at. I just want to make sure that as a team, we make a good decision. We have all the information,
we're not taking public comment right now. Thanks. We're not voting. We're not voting on anything tonight, so we're not taking public comment right now. Thank you,
Commissioner Butcher. I would just echo, as a new commissioner, kind of stepping into a conversation that's obviously been underway for many years, I would find it particularly helpful to be able to take have some time and space to kind of assemble and hear kind of the totality of information and perspectives, and be able to ask those questions. So I'd be very open to that and would be happy to carve out time in my schedule for that kind of deep dive on these are very important questions. This is a very important institution in our community, and I think what you hear from us also is wanting to make sure we're proceeding with proper due diligence on an investment of this magnitude. Thank you for your time tonight. Yeah. Thank you to all of your team who's been here for many hours at this point as well. I'm sure you all started your day early as well. So thank you.
Brownie, yes, sir. I would like to say too, as a new commissioner, I am concerned about Buncombe Tech and to make sure we do the right thing. But I also would like to give you, Dr. King, some advice. I spent 8 years on my board, on my alma mater's board at North Carolina Central, and 8 years on UNC Asheville's board. On both boards, the 16 years I spent, we were building buildings. I've been through a lot of presentations, and normally with my banking experience, it's pretty easy for me to follow. But this has been the most difficult I've encountered. So hopefully we can clear it up.
Well, if you give me the questions, I will get you answers.
Yeah.
You know, I would just add that the there have been a lot of changes to the plan since the concepts were originally developed, when the sales tax referendum was proposed. But I think when you look at the different changes, there's a specific reason each of them was made. You know, the plan was to renovate Rhododendron, but when there was more due diligence done on that project, the decision was made. You know, it really doesn't make sense to renovate this building. A better use of the funding would be to build new space. So there's changes, but part of what I think tonight helped with is sort of understanding why the changes were made and sort of where that leaves us going forward. I would say for myself, I think the most important question I still have that I would like, and I understand some of these are still, there may not be detailed plans on each of them yet, so the costs are not going to be definitive. But for the basic plan and then the other scenario, I would like to have cost estimates on those projects, because I think part of what we're trying to understand is, you know, there's an immediate art science building that the community college is asking us to move forward with. But I think we do want to be as clear as we can about, you know, what are the total capital costs for the for all of the different major capital projects that are currently being actively planned for at AB Tech over the next, you know, 5-6 years, so we can understand that in totality. For me, that's probably the biggest question I still have. Mm-hmm. Any other questions or comments before we while we're still on this for this evening?
No, and I don't want to appear hard. I think
that helps. I don't want to be hard. I firmly support AB Tech, but I also support people in our community, black, white, and purple, who need a skill and to get a job. And I want to hear everything you're doing to help poor people get into the workforce.
Got a question.
All right. We're just acting on recommendation to move this, to continue this at our next meeting. All in favor, please say aye.
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 All opposed. Thank you. Thank you all for being here tonight.
Thank you, guys.
All right. The last item under new business for this evening is the Warren Wilson College pool. So,
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I too realize I owe you some additional information, and we'll make sure I have that because I do have it in my folder. So I'll get that. But if we move on to the next issue on the Warren Wilson pool, in 2005, we set aside $300,000 because we were having access to water issues, Zeugner issues, and so that money has been sitting there for a while. And one of the proposals that has been brought to us is one from Warren Wilson that would give us access to water on the east end of the county. So Steve and Scott are both here with us. Don't know who's going to speak.
Good evening, and thank you. I want to thank you for the time, commissioners. I want to acknowledge my team who's here. I have CFO Scott McKinney, our alumni ambassador, Rodney Lytle, Director of Development, Renee Danger James, our VP for Student Life, Paul Perrine. Are you with us?
I'm with you.
Just with us, a community member. Good. I thought they put in the time they needed to be acknowledged.
You've already forgot your people. That's very weird.
My own name, actually. Swim coach. Oh, and our swim coach. Sorry, we had a couple of trustees who were here early in this evening, and Brett McCall, who's the Owen High swim coach, was also here and had to go to a basketball tournament. Let me try and be direct, honoring the time. We're here with a pretty straightforward opportunity, we think, for the county to repair and reopen the only pool facility in eastern Buncombe County that has significant public access. The college has a 25-yard pool. Was constructed in 1987. The pool itself is in good shape, but the building housing the pool is not. It was not built really to the spec that a natatorium should be built to. Consequently, there was seepage both from above in and from inside out, and we had to take the decision in December of 2014 to close the building. We felt it was not structurally sound, and we have been looking for a way since then to reopen the pool, which is in good shape, by restoring the structure, which is not. And we think we've come up with an opportunity that that brings us here to ask you to collaborate with us. As you know, or I hope you know, Warren Wilson takes very seriously its commitment to engaging with and supporting the community. And this was a pool that was heavily used by community members. Owen High School practiced in that pool and held meets there. We had first responders training in there. We had disabled veterans training in there. We had scouts. We hosted Special Olympics. We are open to community members who have memberships. It is a pool heavily used in the community. In this project, we have been in consultation with Tony Baldwin about reconfirming our commitment to him that we're open and welcoming to local schools using the pool, and he's reconfirmed to us the importance of having this pool open to meet the needs of the school system. The scope of the project is straightforward. We're going to take down the envelope around the building and replace it with a solar structure. I'll show you some pictures of that. It's a simpler and smaller structure, much easier to maintain. We will repair the mechanical, electrical, plumbing, HVAC systems. Because it's a smaller volume, it's a smaller need. And then we'll fix up some of the pool equipment that needs fixing. This is what the structure will look like. I'll be happy to answer questions about it if you want. One of the features is the roof actually opens. It allows us to vent the pool. That allows us to put an HVAC system in that is much less expensive and much simpler to maintain. That's part of the beauty of this system. This is roughly what it looks like on the outside. A simpler HVAC system, pipes just run across the top. This project is ready to go. We have been juggling different engineering solutions. This is sort of a turnkey solution. So from the point at which we have committed funding, we can start construction almost immediately and have the project done and the pool reopened in about 6 to 8 months, which means if we start now, we can actually have this pool available both to our students and to the Owen High students and other users in time for the 2017-2018 swim season. Here's the financing for it. We have a single donor, an anonymous donor, who wants to name the pool for a distinguished alum who's known in the community. That's a $250,000 pledge contingent upon us getting other matching funding, and that's what we're coming to the commission for, is a $300,000 allocation, and then we are matching that with another $50,000 of gifts that we are anticipating, and $200,000 of money that we've gotten for financing from the U.S. Department of Agriculture for capital improvements. So that's the project, and I think with that, I'm happy to answer questions.
Can you bring the last slide back up?
Sure.
And can I just, before we move on to other questions, I just also wanted to add this in context that, so this is, you know, we've, this is an informational presentation. This is not an item that we have to act on tonight, but we wanted to get the information here. Obviously, we've been looking at other, you know, the Zeugner project and other sort of related items. So we felt it was timely to make sure everyone has this information, but it's not a project that there's a request to act on this evening. So questions.
So thanks for waiting. Thanks for the marathon. How much community access would the community have? And, you know, Black Mountain has a thriving swim team. I know there are a lot of senior citizens. I have a lot of Wilson students that work for me and tell me all about the pool. So those are the questions I have. You know, I think this is a good thing, but I would only think it was a good thing unless there was tremendous access to the public for not open swimming, but as far as teams and organized.
Yes, if I could just back that up to that this is not an exhaustive list of the groups that used it. So it was Owen High, it was Asheville Christian Academy. We could probably accommodate another high school swim team in there, and Tony Baldwin was with us out at the pool about a week or two ago talking about possibilities around it. Basically, the need countywide for pool space is extreme, and Brett McCall, the Owen High coach, was saying that his team this year had to drive to McDowell at 5:30 in the morning to get pool time. And so so we're committed to having the pool used not just by members of our college community, but by the surrounding community. And we see this as a resource for certainly for East Buncombe County, and we could accommodate other teams coming in, other school teams coming in.
I think Black Mountain Swim has about 100 kids, and that number's dropped down a little bit because they don't access, but yeah.
Yeah, I think the last time we were running numbers was when the pool was open. It was a couple of hundred for sure, but I don't have that at my fingertips. 150, I think, was a number that we had come
for
up
Black
with
Mountain Swim Team?
No, I'm talking about this pool.
Oh, gotcha.
What's the policy around whether those organizations and schools pay any kind of fee to use the pool?
There's the before and there's the after. The policy before, if they paid, was nominal. It was low fees comparison to that. However, the pool at that time was completely privately financed. So presumably, if the county joins us in this collaboration to get the pool back open, we would reach a user agreement with the county, and if that if part of that agreement was that Owen High School would not be charged a user fee or whatever, this is all something we could discuss as part of the agreement to move forward.
So can you get that last slide?
Yeah, the budget slide.
Yeah. So you said something about the state
USDA.
Yes.
Yeah, where is that in those?
That's where the college capital budget is coming from in part. We were fortunate enough to be able to secure USDA financing to refinance the college debt, and there was some margin in there for some new projects, and so that's where the $200,000 is coming from, is some of the allocation of capital projects from that.
Okay. So,
I just want to add that financing was supported by the county wrote a letter of support for us, for which we're grateful.
So my understanding, the pool is unusually deep on one end?
It is a diving pool on one end, yes.
So as we look at this, that would limit some community swimming.
It hasn't in the past. So among the programs that we offered was swimming, both for children and adults. You just do it in the shallower part of the pool.
Is it big enough in the shallow end?
Yes. Yeah. It's shallow until about midway in the pool, and then there's the diving part.
And I would note, I think one of the kind of virtues of that is that that the deepness actually makes it a bit more advantageous from an emergency services personnel training facility. The folks who practice training for emergency response in pools, the fact that it's deeper actually makes it a little bit more valuable for doing the trainings that they do.
Buoyancy.
So I appreciate the information. I'm going to say one thing and I'm going to hush. I'm not opposed to pools located in various parts of the county that can be utilized by, the public and others. It's a source of recreation for families, and a source of them coming together, and and this being inside is not a bad thing. So I'm not opposed to that. It is a challenge tonight, though, where I like planning for this. If we're gonna have a pool for Zorgner, if we're gonna have something somewhere else, if we're gonna have, the county, and this is not directed at you at all. This is just discussion of this. Not reacting to, the pool's been down for a while, now we're gonna go ahead and build it, and now we got a great need over there. Well, if we had a great need, we'd already built it. If we had the money and we had a great need, then we'd have already advocated for this and already pushed for it and maybe got it done before. So I just want to make sure that whatever we're doing, that that we're meeting a need, and there's good and proper planning, for it throughout the county. Whether we have, two pools or we have 10 pools, that we're doing it that way. But I thank you for the information this evening.
Well, and to Commissioner Belcher, I think it's great to hear about this. I appreciate you willing to come for informational. But I also, if we can put out to the rest of the community other places that have pools in different parts of the county, if they would, be open to the same kind of model that, Warren Wilson is putting forward to expand swim access.
Absolutely. The only other comment I would just kind of just add to this, as we think about this project in the context of other recreational projects that we'll be considering in the, you know, in the coming budget process. You know, when the Zeugner issue, you know, came back up, and you know, we looked at that and what's the right solution to that, and the schools are funding that project, but. And that new facility will be, I mean, this isn't the exact same thing, but it's not also in some ways that different in terms of the size of the facility, the, you know, the water resource. And that is a $6 million project.
Right.
Right. So that is a $6 million project also with, you know, not insignificant annual recurring operating costs.
Right.
So, I mean, in a way, as we think about this opportunity to partner compared to other various opportunities that are out there, this is a similar type of project that costs $300,000 instead of $6 million, and the college pays all the operating costs forever. So in terms of additional water resources in the county, it's probably, you know, in many ways the most cost-effective opportunity that I'll ever come across our desk. So for all those different reasons, I think we felt it was important to get a full update on this, because there's been a few meetings with the schools, and some people have been looped in, so we wanted everyone to be thinking about this as we weigh those different projects we'll be talking about.
If I could add, Mr. Chairman, I mean, I think that's exactly right. That's why I refer to it as an opportunity. I think this is a terrific opportunity to create this resource at a really affordable cost for the county. I would add that just two other things. One is the college does have a small endowment for pool operations. So we have thought about and had in the past thought about the need to provide for upkeep and maintenance of the pool, and so the county can be assured that we are good stewards of this resource. I also feel that I should add, I understand that this is a very complex puzzle you're putting together. However, the first line there of our donor is one where we are concerned that at a certain point that donor will take their money elsewhere. And so I understand that you have a lot of pieces to come together, but I would hope that we might be able to get some clear signal from the county to be able to lock in that grant. Because we've been playing a little whack-a-mole here with public funding, private funding, and the engineering solutions. And whenever two of them line up, one of them comes out of sync.
What I like about it is that we're getting more than our bang for our buck. And it's a community partnership. And this is something going forward we need to do more of, because it's going to save the taxpayers money. We're looking out for our constituents. Plus, we're filling a gap in the county that's needed, even if we get the Zeugner pool, which will be there. So to me, folks, it's no-brainer. You know, I think, and if I'm in mayor, I would like to put forth a motion that we do it.
You may do that.
May I ask a couple quick questions as the motion hangs in the air? I refer to my District 2 colleagues and friends in the eastern part of the county in just trying to understand, does this solution meet the need for swimming facilities in the eastern part of the county in a way that would be comprehensive and accessible to folks in terms of geography, in terms of cost and affordability? If the answer to that is yes, this does seem like a very strong proposal, but I'd like to hear input from.
So I certainly think that it does with all the assurances of community availability. We're kind of like a desert out there, no pun. But you know, I would second the motion with the assurance that we have access, Black Mountain Swim Team, which is separate from Owen High, and also that that our money be last. You know, you have the commitment of our money coming, but it would be last to the project.
All right, there's a motion and a second. Further discussion?
Commissioner Fryer.
I agree, and I do agree with you, Ms. Frost, on the our money's last in it, because that way it gives more incentive, and you know we will have the money to be able to do it. So I'm there. The parking is the only thing I've seen that I've heard that's not the greatest deal out there at the present time. And then you got your pool's like 14 foot deep at the deep end or something.
It's deep at the deep end. Do you know it?
That's a deep pool, man.
Nobody knows for sure how deep it is. That's how deep it is.
Yeah. Nobody's ever gotten nobody's
to the in China the
nobody's
last time.
Went down there. Okay.
There may be a car in there you need to check.
Brad Darty.
It's deep.
It's deep.
Robertson, Brad Darty, deep.
Very deep.
I am, you know, I'll go along with the motion with Ellen's, you know, the second, and she seconded it. I'm fine with it, but the main thing we have to do is being the last in is what we'd really, that sets it, and that tells us that y'all are going to work hard to get our money.
Okay, so we weren't, you're a new commissioner, but you jumped right out there and did this like that, didn't you? And we're just supposed to talk about it.
I've been in Buncombe.
You have, haven't you?
You have.
I know you have. I'm not going to, I take that as a compliment, but anyhow. We're neither one of us spring chickens anymore, are we?
No mean.
Okay, so I just want to make sure that the,
I keep thinking at some point I should sit down, but
no, not yet. I think there's some questions I heard from Commissioner Farrar here. I heard that. I think there's some questions that we need to know. We're not doing the maintenance. We're Owen is going to be using it.
Black,
you know,
Mountain
that
swim team.
Black Mountain
Black
swim Mountain team. And we've talked about some things, which was the intent of this meeting tonight, was to talk about it. But during that conversation, it looks like, you know, with which I did not know the $250,000 until tonight. And so with that information, it makes this a deal that it appears that we want to do. But we can't just do that without having these, you know, whatever it is, one, two, three. We've mm-hmm. got Last In, we've got the Black Mountain, we've got Owen School, we've got these things need to be documented and be part of the Last In on our funding.
Mm-hmm. And so we could draft a document to support all of those recommendations.
Okay.
So if it's approved tonight, could we make actual appropriation of the funds contingent upon execution of an operating agreement between the county and the college, which would presumptively be approved on a future consent agenda? Because I think we're all saying right. The same things. But so if that document can be worked out, we'll approve the funds contingent upon signing a legal document to confirm all of that.
And so we would have to go to the minutes. And it's pretty obvious the things that were suggested that need to be in that document. And
we,
so as a friendly to
we
their,
can watch the tape.
I'd just like to make sure that we address maximum access at low cost, partly in the spirit of equity and access for lower income folks. So just making a particular note that that's...
Well, Swannanoa needs that. I mean, that area over there, they just need that.
They need it.
Yeah. And I'll get you in just a minute. Any other things that, just while we're on this topic, anything else that people feel it's important for the county manager to hear that need to be included within the operating partnership agreement? Anything else? I think we've heard, you know, maintenance, public use, costs.
Black Mountain Swim Team and Owen High specifically. Black Mountain Swim
Black
Club.
Mountain and Owen High. Okay. Yeah.
And Last
the two.
Yeah. And our funding would be spent last on the project when we know the project will be successfully completed. All right. Any others? All right. I think so. I think we've laid those out. Mr. Sully, do you have a comment, or are you just waiting for us to do something?
The gentleman in the Navy shirt.
All right. I will, you, sir, and then if anyone else has any other public comments before we vote, we'll hear those, and then we'll take a vote.
Great. Thank you all.
Thank you.
2 minutes.
My name's Doug Thigpen. I know a good many of your folks up here on the dais. I live 2.5 miles from Warren Wilson College, and since the late 80s, on and off, I've been over there swimming 3-4 days a week till they closed in December 2014. Now I have this, since I'm not. But with regard to the issue of accessibility and usage, I can tell you that it was my observation that when I get there at 9 o'clock in the morning or 8:30, the master swimmers were finishing up. They had been in there boiling that water for an hour and a half. And then from about 8:30 till noon or so, us old folks would get in there and we'd swim our laps, and it was pretty tame, but that pool was getting used. And it wasn't too long after that that we'd start having classes, aerobics classes showing up and private swim lessons. And then in the afternoon, you'd see the swim teams. A couple of times when I didn't get there in the morning, I got to go in the afternoon, and I got to wait for a lane because this pool's being used. And it's being used by the school swim team. And just all I want to do is have the input that the pool does get used a lot. And it was quite a resource in East Buncombe County, and we didn't, nothing would be better than for Buncombe County to quit letting Haywood County and Johnson City, quit letting them put us to shame with their swimming facility that they have for swim meets. And build a real good one. But until then, we're going to have to do some stopgap measures. This is an awfully cheap way to do one, isn't it, to cover the whole east half of the county. So, thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Yelton.
When we get the board's number.
Kind of like a city council meeting, isn't it, Chairman Newman? And I want to thank you all for asking questions and addressing the issue of the maintenance to the pool. And I think, Chairman Newman, you learned if you just keep your mouth shut and let them do the talking, they'll pass and get what you want for your alumni, so I think that's good. But I want to congratulate you in public for one thing. You can't believe that, can you? You better start learning the life. You better start learning the life. David Gett did. But see, I have to pay $8 to $10 to sit here and have this entertainment. But it beats any movie I ever go to. But I want to thank you for taking public comment before votes. That goes back to old Tom Sobel days, which Chairman Ramsey and Chairman Gett never did. I hope you continue that, because that's part of that open and transparency. And I want to thank you for that, and thank you for passing this $300,000. It's a good deal. Plus, I want to request a personal meeting with you for about 20 minutes sometime. I'll send you an email. I want to talk about River Basin-based taxation and the things that we've talked about before. Thank you.
Sounds great. Thank you. Any other comments? All right, there's a motion.
Jerry.
I'm sorry, Mr. Rice.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I'm glad you're going to stay late. You get paid well for it. I would like to see more information on the agenda. I know that this resolution, the way you're doing it, sounds good, but having no information to really talk about, because when you're talking about the Ziegler pool, you're talking about this pool, and then you're talking about other pools, how does that all combine together? We're not hearing that. And to me, these isolated pieces without seeing the whole picture is not a good idea. Not to approve something just because it sounds good and it looks good on paper. Let's see how it fits together with all the puzzles, because we've had a big discussion about swimming. Seemed like it's all on the south end, you know, because they've got the money and the lawyers and the doctors on that end. They seem to get about it whatever they want. The east end is just as important, but in this whole scheme of looking at the whole thing, I think we need to look at the whole thing, because we had a lot of discussion about how all this puzzle was going to fit together. A lot of you weren't privy to that information, the new members anyway. So are you getting what I'm saying? $300,000, I don't have a problem with what I'm hearing tonight, but I don't know how it fits into the program. So that's my beef.
Great. Thank you. Yeah, and before we vote, I would just like to kind of respond to that comment. We had a great retreat last week where we talked about some of our policies and procedures, and one of the other ones that we didn't, kind of ran out of time before we got to it, but I think there is internal agreement that we are going to, you know, for future meetings, we are going to ask that all the presentations be given to the commission so that all of that information will be live on the county website when we post the agenda 1 week before the meetings. I mean, in some cases, things come up kind of at the last minute, and you can't have all of it, but wherever possible, that will be the standard that we are going to be operating under. So thanks for that comment. Any other comments before we vote? All in favor of the motion made by Commissioner Whiteside, seconded by Commissioner Frost? Say aye, please.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? Passes unanimously. All right. Thank you all for being here. Thank you for this partnership opportunity. And we look forward to hammering out the details on that. We do have just a couple of board appointments to...
A couple.
We're going to... Got a lot of board appointments to go through. So let's take a look at those. And let's just walk through these. There are a number where I anticipate we will want to do interviews. There might be some where we can take action tonight. So,
Chairman, there are two that require reappointments. And so I would like to make a motion on those two, and then we can kind of weigh in if that's okay.
Let's do each board one at a time.
All right.
Okay.
What's the first one?
The first one is the Board of Adjustments. There's four reappointments. I make a motion for Roberta Taylor, Becco, Lisa Stevens, Tom Christ.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Can you wait one
second? Sure, we'll hold off for a second. So we're on the County Board of Adjustments, which is the second to the last on the list of the boards on our agenda. It's the second to the bottom. Thank you. And there's these are all reappointments.
Reappointments. Oh, okay. Reappointments.
All right. So any questions? All in favor of reappointing the four members, please say aye.
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 All opposed.
One other one, the Board of Equalization and Review. There's four reappointments and one vacancy. We only have five people. So that Miriam McKinney, Michael Kisnick, Mark Morris, Jim Edmonds, Debbie Lane. Make that motion.
Second.
All right, who seconded that? All right, seconded by Commissioner Fryer. And that is reappointing, well, the new appointment is Miriam McKinney. The other four are reappoints.
Yes.
Any questions? All in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? All right. Let's go back to the top of the list. The Women's Commission, there's a proposal to appoint County Commissioner Beach Ferrara as our liaison. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
HRC, Historic Resources Commission, there's two vacancies and four appointments. I would recommend we interview these candidates.
I would agree.
Okay.
Second.
We don't need to vote on it. So just again, as a protocol, if anybody wants to interview candidates, we will. So it sounds like there's definitely folks who do. So we don't need to vote on those, but we'll set up interviews.
Okay.
Juvenile Crime Prevention Council, there's two candidates and one vacancy.
A thought is that they're going to get lucky and get in after the deadline. I would suggest we interview these,
But normally they've got to meet the deadline. Is that right?
They're saying they did meet the deadline. I'm saying I didn't see it. I can't argue today because I don't know. They may be right.
I don't have a problem with doing three, though.
Yeah.
Can we go ahead and interview?
Do that too.
Can we just interview the three then?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we'll interview all three. Health and Human Services, there's six appointments, there's five candidates, so...
I'd like to make a motion we appoint all five. I know them...
All right, there's a motion and a second. Discussion? Hearing no discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed. There's one additional position for that, which we'll continue to seek applicants for, right?
Yeah, we
okay.
need to.
Well, there's, okay. The Audit Committee, there's one vacancy, and Mike Nepshield is applied.
I know him. I worked with him.
Second.
Yeah.
All right, so there's a motion from Commissioner Whiteside, seconded by Commissioner Belcher. Any comments? All in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? AB Tech Board of Trustees, I'd like to recommend we keep that open for the time being.
Is that our appointment?
That's our appointment.
Yeah.
All right. Let's see. Land Conservation Board, there's two candidates and two vacancies.
I'll make a motion for Joel Mazalis and Slater Solomon.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Downtown Commission, one vacancy, one applicant, Toby Weiss.
I nominate Toby Weiss.
Second.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
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 Nursing Home Advisory Committee, there's two applicants for three vacancies.
Thank the Lord. Susan Scheimer and Eva Chang. I'll recommend them.
Second.
All right. Motion and second. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
So just a statement on that. We don't get a lot of folks that apply for that, do we?
We're doing more now.
Are we?
Than we have been.
Well, that's good. I'm glad to hear
good,
that.
Yeah.
I was going to put in a plug for it. I'm glad to hear it.
Adult Care Home Community Advisory Committee. There's five vacancies. We've got two applicants.
I'll nominate.
Make motion.
Okay.
Okay, motion by Commissioner Fryer, seconded by Commissioner Frost to appoint the two applicants listed. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? And last, the Agriculture Advisory Board, there's one vacancy and one applicant.
I'll nominate Brandon Hensley.
Second.
So motion and second. All in any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
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 All opposed. Thank you, everyone. I just have one announcement.
Closed session. Do we have one?
Do we have a closed session? Do we have a closed session?
We don't.
Mr. Attorney? There is no closed session. On March 7th at 5 p.m., the regular meeting of the County Commissioners will be in 200 College Street, room 326 in downtown Asheville. There's no other business. We are adjourned.